وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد Inshallah ta'ala, in this episode I want to speak about the importance of refuting. And inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to give principles from the Sharia regarding this, inshallah ta'ala. My beloved brothers and sisters, refuting is a symbol from the symbols of Islam. And it is an obligation from the obligations of the Sharia. And it is also a sunnah from the sunan of our Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and his students, the companions, and the tabi'een, abram tidadi zamani fil hayat al-islamiyya, until our day-to-day. Refutation has been something that has been present in our religion. And it has also been a means to protect the boundaries of the religion. So our religion can remain safiyan naqiyan yatala'la. Our religion can remain pure, clean, untampered, as it was at the time of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, kama kana ala minhajin nubuwa. And anyone who really ponders nususul wahyayni sharifayn, al-Qur'an wa sunnah, and looks at the kalam of the ulama al-muhaqqiqin, you would find many examples, many evidences. And these evidences are dalalatun qat'iyya, clear-cut evidences that don't take any interpretation, that affirm refutation is something praiseworthy and honorable in our religion. Let's take that which has come in the Qur'an. And then inshallah ta'ala, that which has come in the sunnah. And I'm also going to bring consensus that have been transmitted from the ulama of al-Islam, abra al-Qurun, what they said regarding refutation. Let's start with the Qur'an. And that, inshallah wa ta'ala, will show us the importance of it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said in the Qur'an,
وَقَالُوا لَنْ يَدْخُلَ الْجَنَّةَ إِلَّا مَنْ كَانَ هُودًا أَوْ نَصَارًا تِلْكَ أَمَانِيُّهُمْ قُلْ هَاتُوا بُرْهَانَكُمْ إِن كُنتُمْ صَادِقِينَ
Allah says, وَقَالُوا, they said, the Jews,
لَنْ يَدْخُلَ الْجَنَّةَ,
they will not enter Jannah.
إِلَّا مَنْ كَانَ هُودًا أَوْ نَصَارًا
The Jews, they said, no one will enter Jannah unless he's a Jew. The Christians, they said, no one will enter Jannah unless he's a Christian. Allah then says, now Allah's refuting them. Allah's going to refute them. They brought a claim, a statement, baseless statement, not backed with any evidence. Allah says,
تِلْكَ أَمَانِيُّهُمْ
That's their wishful thinking.
قُلْ هَاتُوا بُرْهَانَكُمْ إِن كُنتُمْ صَادِقِينَ
Bring your evidences forward. Where's your proof for the statement of yours? Also Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he said in Surah Al-Anbiya,
أَمِ اتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِهِ آلِيَةً قُلْ هَاتُوا بُرْهَانَكُمْ هَذَا ذِكْرُ مَنْ مَعِيَ وَذِكْرُ مَنْ قَبْلِي بَلْ أَكْثَرُهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ الْحَقَّ فَهُمْ مُعْرِضُونَ
Allah says, أَمِ اتَّخَذُوا They took besides Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, أَمِ اتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِهِ آلِهَةً Besides Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, they took ilah in which they worship. قُلْ هَاتُوا بُرْهَانَكُمْ Say to them, Muhammad, هَاتُوا بُرْهَانَكُمْ Bring us your evidences. Give us evidence and proofs for what you guys are claiming, that there can be worship someone other than Allah. هَذَا ذِكْرُ مَنْ مَعِيَ وَذِكْرُ مَنْ قَبْلِي بَلْ أَكْثَرُهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ الْحَقَّ فَهُمْ مُعْرِضُونَ And then Allah exposes them by referring to them as those who don't have no knowledge. They have no understanding. And they are turning away. Allah is refuting them, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah is demanding from them in both of the ayahs that I mentioned, the ayah Surah Al-Baqarah and the Surah Al-Anbiya, both of them Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is saying to them, bring your proofs forward. What's your evidence for your claim? وَقَالُوا لَنْ يَدْخُلَ الْجَنَّةِ إِلَّا مَنْ كَانَ هُودًا أَوْ نَصَارَى تِلْكَ أَمَانِيُّهُمْ قُلْ هَاتُوا بُرْهَانَكُمْ. Where's your evidence for this? Where's your evidence for it? Also Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Anbiya, He said, أَمِ اتَّخَذُوا مِنْ دُونِ آلِهَةٍ قُلْ هَاتُوا بُرْهَانَكُمْ هَذَا ذِكْرُ مَنْ مَعِي وَذِكْرُ مَنْ قَبْلِي بَلْ أَكْثَرُهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ الْحَقَّ فَهُمْ مُعْرِضُونَ. This is just a claim of yours. Where's your evidence? Where's your proof? So Allah is refuting subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran. Also Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He says in Surah Al-Ma'idah, وَقَالَتِ الْيَهُودُ وَالنَّصَارَى نَحْنُ أَبْنَاءُ اللَّهِ وَأَحِبَّاؤُهُ قُلْ فَلِمَ يُعَذِّبُكُمْ بِذُنُوبِكُمْ بَلْ أَنْتُمْ بَشَرٌ مِّمَّنْ خَلَقَ يَغْفِرُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيُعَذِّبُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. Allah says, وَقَالَتِ الْيَهُودُ وَالنَّصَارَى نَحْنُ أَبْنَاءُ اللَّهِ وَأَحِبَّاءُ. The Christians and the Jews, they claimed, they came with a false claim. What did they say? نَحْنُ أَبْنَاءُ اللَّهِ. We are the children of Allah. وَأَحِبَّاءُ. We are the ones who are most beloved to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Allah then says, قُلْ فَلِمَ يُعَذِّبُكُمْ بِذُنُوبِكُمْ. And then why is Allah punishing you for your sins? بَلْ أَنْتُمْ بَشَرٌ. All you are is just human beings. مِمَّنْ خَلَقَ that Allah creates. يَغْفِرُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيُعَذِّبُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. Allah punishes who He wishes and He forgives whoever He wishes, subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's just a claim. Allah is refuting them, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also Allah tabarak wa ta'ala عز من قائل, He said, إِنَّ مَثَلَ عِيسَى عِندَ اللَّهِ كَمَثَلِ آدَمْ خَلَقَهُ مِن تُرَابٍ ثُمَّ قَالَ لَهُ كُن فَيَكُون. Allah says, إِنَّ مَثَلَ عِيسَى عِندَ اللَّهِ كَمَثَلِ آدَمٍ. Isa is like Adam. They're the same in terms of creation. Both of them are created by Allah. None of them are the children of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّ مَثَلَ عِيسَى عِندَ اللَّهِ كَمَثَلِ آدَمٍ خَلَقَهُ مِن تُرَابٍ. Allah created them from, both of them from turab. ثُمَّ قَالَ لَهُ كُن فَيَكُون. And Allah said to both of them, be, and they became. Allah is refuting the Christians who claim because Isa doesn't have a father, then his father must be Allah. Allah is refuting them subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is saying Adam doesn't have a father or a mother. Ma'adhalika, he's what? Created by Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And so is Isa ibn Maryam. So the Quranic discourse, when you really ponder and you look, it's refuting all the false ideologies and the false beliefs that humans have held for centuries and decades. Allah refutes them in the Quran subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, if you look at the sunnah of our messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and again, in the sunnah there are things which are da'if and there are things which are sahih. I'm talking about things that have come in fi sunnah al-sahiha, authentic narrations. For example, the narration that's found in sunnah Abi Dawood, al-imam Abi Dawood narrated in his sunan, isnaduhu inshallah ta'ala is sahih. When hadith Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu, may Allah be pleased with him, he said, I heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, jahidu al-mushrikeen, fight with the mushrikeen. Bi amwalikum, fight with them with your wealth. Wa anfusikum, and your nafs, fight with them. Wa al-sinatikum, and fight with them with your tongue. So Allah tabarak wa ta'ala mentioned that the jihad is three. There's jihadul amwal, you spend and you give to the mujahideen. You say, take, this is money for the mujahideen, you give it. Wa anfusikum, and you do jihad with your nafs. Jihadu nafs, you fight with your nafs. And this is the jihad ma'al kufar, because he says jahidul mushrikeena. Wa al-sinatikum, and you do jihad with your tongue. You do jihad with what? With your tongue. How do you do jihad with your tongue? Any falsehood, any corruption, any misguidance that's put towards Islam, you defend it with your tongue. What do? That's jihadul lisan. So ar-radd ala al-mukhalifin, refuting the people who oppose the truth, whether they be mushrikeen, whether they be mubtadi'ah, whether they be from the usat al-muslimina, from the sinners amongst the Muslims, you have to do the jihad that the Prophet commanded us sallallahu alayhi wa sallam here, which is jihadul lisan. Because this hadith is a command. Jahidu, the Prophet said. And in the Arabic language, or in usulul fiqh, if anyone of you studied it, You will know that jahidu is a command, and the command shows in our religion obligation. If it comes from Allah and His Messenger, al-amru yaqtadi al-wujub. The amr shows obligation. No, it shows obligation. The second evidence, inshallah ta'ala, from the prophetic sunnah, from our messengers, which are authentic, is Yawm al-Hunayn. The day of Hunayn, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam refuted a man who said, wallahi inna hadihi al-qisma ma udila fiha wa ma urida biha wajh Allah. Wa ma urida biha wajh Allah. The man said, this يعني, giving, and the way that Muhammad, you have chosen to divide the spoils of war, ma udila fiha, justice was not served in it. Wa ma urida biha wajh Allah, Allah's face was not seeked. Yani Allah's face, yani Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, was not done with sincerity. He was not done with ikhlas. فَقَالَ لَهُ النَّبِيُّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَسَلَّمَ. The Prophet refuted him, صلى الله عليه وسلم. He said, فَمَنْ يَعْدِلُ إِذَا لَمْ يَعْدِلِ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. Who's going to be just if Allah and His Messenger are not just? رَحِمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى قَدْ أُوذِيَ بِأَكْثَرَ مِنْ هَذَا فَصَبَرْ. May Allah have mercy upon Musa. نبي الله موسى. May Allah have mercy upon him. قَدْ أُوذِيَ بِأَكْثَرَ مِنْ هَذَا. He was put through hardship, and he was put through يعني, pain and suffering more than this, and he showed patience. This hadith, Al-Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim both narrated min hadith Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu. The third evidence from the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam is hadith Abi Sa'id al-Khudri narrated, and it's found in Musnad al-Imam Ahmad, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, he said, la yamna'anna ahadakum, do not let one of you stop him. مخافة الناس أن يتكلم بحق إذا شهده أو علمه. Do not let. And another word in the Prophet ﷺ said هيبة الناس instead of مخافة الناس. Instead of here it says مخافة الناس. In another word in the Prophet said هيبة الناس. Do not let fear that you're scared of the people, or veneration and honoring the people, you leave off what? A truth that you saw or you witnessed. To speak it and to say what you believe in this matter. Don't leave it off. Fear because you're scared of the people, what they might say about you. Or trying to respect the people. Oh, and so much of us are like this. Walil asaf al-shadeed. That we know the truth in the matter. We know the haq is in this issue. But we're silent about it and we're quiet. And we don't say anything about it. Why are we doing it? Makhafatun nas, fear of the people. Haybatun nas, we're honoring the people. Over who? Allah Azza wa Jalla. We're scared of the people more than Allah. We're honoring the people more than Allah. We're scared what the people might say about us. Are the people going to bring out my faults? Are the people going to bring out my mistakes? That's what many of us are falling into. Ya ikhwati al-kiram, don't be scared of anyone except Allah Azza wa Jalla. Surrender your affairs to Allah, and Allah, tawakkal ala Allah. When you see a mistake and you see a falsehood, and you have the knowledge and the understanding, speak it. Don't be scared of the people. That's what the Prophet is telling us. He said, لا يمنعن أحدكم مخافة الناس أن يتكلم بحق إذا شهده أو علمه. You saw the truth. You saw falsehood. You recognized it. You have the knowledge and the understanding. Get up and stand up and mention that this is wrong and this is what is right. That's what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying to us. And I've met so many people who don't like speaking about things. And people think because they're humble, Allahumma barik, and they praise, the people praise that person more. They'll say, look, that brother doesn't go into, يعني, he doesn't get himself into predicaments, and he doesn't get himself in unnecessary conflict. He keeps himself to himself. He's a very righteous person. He doesn't backbite. He doesn't refute. That's what they say about him. The truth of the matter is like him. That's not what how Allah and His Messenger scale the matter. Allah and His Messenger, they say and they mention that if you see falsehood and you see batil, don't leave it for fear of the people and what the people might say, how the people might see it. Say it, speak it. Also, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he refuted three men in an action that they did. Refuted it sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They came to the Prophet's house and spoke to the Prophet's wives sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they asked about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's ibadah. And they were informed. And the narrations mentioned, فَلَمَّا أُخْبِرُوا, when they were told, كَأَنَّهُمْ تَقَالُوهَا, they saw that it was little. فَقَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. The Prophet said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, وَاللَّهِ, he refuted them. He's mentioning what they did was wrong. He said, وَاللَّهِ إِنِّي لَأَخْشَاكُمْ لِلَّهِ وَأَتْقَاكُمْ لَهِ. I am the one who fears Allah the most. I am the most pious one from amongst all of you. The Prophet is saying this. لَكِنِّي أَصُومْ وَأُفْطِرْ. But I fast and I break my fast. وَأُصَلِّي وَأَرْقُدْ. I pray at night and I sleep. وَأَتَزَوَّجُ النِّسَاءَ. And I marry women. فَمَنْ رَغِبَ عَنْ سُنَّتِي فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي. Anyone who leaves a matter from my sunnah and shows desires to other than my sunnah is not from amongst me. And anyone who goes towards innovation is not from me. Al-Imam al-Bukhari narrated this in his Sahih min hadith Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu. The fifth is a man sought permission from the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Hadith al-Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim both narrated min hadith Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. Anna rajulan istadana ala al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasalam. A man sought permission from the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. If he can let him in. فقال ذنو. The Prophet said, let him in. And then the Prophet said, بِئْسَ أَخُ الْعَشِيرَةِ. بِئْسَ أَخُ الْعَشِيرَةِ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam said, tribe so-and-so, an evil man is from amongst them. This man is an evil man from that tribe. An evil person is verily from that tribe. That's what the Prophet said alayhi salatu wasalam here. Allahu Akbar. And some people today, if they hear something like that, they're like, akhi, fear Allah, why are you backbiting? No, the Prophet has to explain the matter to the people and tell them who's good and who's bad. Salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. Also, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, may Allah be pleased with her and her father. She said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, look at the Prophet saying this, by the way, brothers. The Prophet said, ma adhunnu fulanan wa fulanan ya'rifani min dinina shay'a. The Prophet said, so-and-so and so-and-so, I don't think they have any knowledge of our religion. Nabi Muhammad is saying this. Ma adhunnu, I do not think, fulanan wa fulanan ya'rifani min dinina shay'a. I don't think they know anything about our religion. And Imam al-Bukhari narrated this in his Sahih. Al-Layth ibn Sa'd was one of the ruwat, the great imam, Imam Ahli Misra, the imam of the people of Egypt, Al-Layth ibn Sa'd, and he's one of the narrators of the hadith. He says, rahimahullah wa rahmatan wasi'a, hadan ar-rajulani, these two men were what? Kana min al-munafiqin, they were hypocrites, hiding amongst the Muslims. The Prophet wanted the people to know, recognize these two men. The Prophet wanted to warn the people from these two people who were hiding within the Muslims, trying to show themselves as Muslims. The Prophet wanted to expose them, alayhi salatu wasalam. So he said, ma adhunnu fulanan wa fulanan ya'rifani min dinina shay'a. I don't think these two men know anything about our religion. The seventh evidence is qissatu Subay'at al-Aslamiyya. Lama tufi anha zawjuha. Subay'at al-Aslamiyya, her husband died. His name was Sa'd ibn Khawla. And he died aam hajjat al-Wada', the year of the Hajjat al-Wada', when the Prophet did his final sermon. That was the last Hajj that the Prophet did. That year, Sa'd ibn Khawla passed away, and he was the husband of Subay'at al-Aslamiyya. Subay'at al-Aslamiyya was pregnant. When her husband died, وَضَعَتْ بَعْدَهُ بِلَيَالٍ. After few nights, she gave birth to a child. Abu Sanabil ibn Ba'kakin, رحم رضي الله تعالى عنه, he said to her, he gave a fatwa to her. She gave birth, what? After her husband passed away, Sa'd ibn Khawla, she gave birth. And Abu Sanabil ibn Ba'kakin, he said to her, you can't get married. No, don't get married. Until 4 months and 10 days goes by. And we know in the ayah, وَالَّذِينَ يُتَوَفَّوْنَ مِنْكُمْ وَيَذَرُونَ أَزْوَاجًا. The woman who lost her husband, her mother's husband passed away. What is it that's upon her to do? If her husband passes away and he dies from her, what does she do? The ayah mentions, 4 months and 10 days, she has to hold back, wait, is her iddah period, and then she can go and get married. Okay, then she can start thinking about getting married. Subay'at al-Islamiyya, she gave birth to a child. Are we all together, brothers? She's not under that same ruling. What's her ruling? Her ruling is, as Allah mentioned, وَأُولَاتُ الْأَحْبَارِ أَجَلُهُنَّ أَنْ يَضَعَنْ حَمْلَهُنَّ. The women who are pregnant, their iddah is when they give birth. That's it. Her iddah is finished now. If her husband dies and one day later she gives birth, then that's it. Khalas, she can get married the day after. Are we all together, brothers? So this sahabi gave a wrong answer to her. He gave a wrong fatwa to her. So she wasn't happy with it. She doesn't know the answer yet. So Bay'at al-Aslamiyyah, when Abu Salab ibn Ba'kakin said this to her, she ran to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and she said, Ya Rasulallah, this is what Abu Salab said to me. The Prophet said, Kadaba Abu Salab. Abu Salab has lied. Qad halalti fatazawaji. You are now permitted to go and get married. Go and get married, Subayah. And Imam al-Bukhari narrated this and also Muslim. Pay attention to this. This Sahabi gave a wrong fatwa. The Prophet said, Kadaba Abu Salab. Here we learn from it, brothers and sisters, we take a benefit from this, is that if somebody speaks wrong, even if they didn't intend to say something, they intend a lie. But if it goes against the reality, we are allowed to say kadaba. Because the word kadab, I'm a kadib, is used for anything that is mukhalifu lilwaqa. It's a position to the reality. And I'll advise you to go to the kitab of Du'afa ibn Adi. He makes a whole chapter where he talks about that the salaf using the word kadaba for somebody who did a mistake. ولذلك شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية, he says, رحمه الله تعالى, ولهذا يتغير الدين بالتبديل تارة وبالنسخ أخرى وهذا الدين لا ينسخ أبدا. Ibn Taymiyyah, he says, the religion changes because of alteration. يعني one, which is تغيير, it gets changed. Or تبديل. The second one is وبالنسخ, abrogation. The religion gets changed through two ways. The first one is التبديل, it gets changed, it gets altered, it's played around with. The second one is بالنسخ, abrogation. وهذا الدين لا ينسخ. This religion is not abrogated. أبدا. لكن يكون فيه من يدخل من التحريف والتبديل والكذب والكتمان ما يلبس به الحق بالباطل ولا بد أن يقيم الله فيه من تقوم به الحجة خلفا عن الرسل فينفون عنه تحريف الغالين وانتحال المبطلين وتأويل الجاهلين فيحق الله الحق ويبطل الباطل ولو كره المشركون فالكتب المنزلة من السماء والآثارة من العلم المأثورة عن خاتم الأنبياء يميز الله بها الحق يميز الله الحق يميز الله بها الحق من الباطل ويحكم بين الناس فيما اختلفوا فيه. This religion or the religions or any religion, the way that it gets changed is either through التبديل, it gets changed, or abrogation. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah said this religion is not going to be abrogated. It's the last and final religion. It's the religion Allah is pleased with, subhanahu wa ta'ala. But it could be played around with. He said it could happen that some people enter into Islam and they bring into the religion at-tahrif, distortion, wal-tabdeel, changing, wal-kadhib, lying, wal-kitman, concealing. And then what happens? مَا يُلَبَّسُ بِالْحَقُّ بِالْبَاطِلِ. The truth then gets mixed up with the falsehood. Then he said, وَلَا بُدَّ, it is necessary. أَنْ يُقِيمَ اللَّهُ فِي مَنْ تَقُومُ بِالْحُجَّةُ خَلَفًا عَنِ الرُّسُلِ. There has to be a people who stand up, taking the places of the messengers and the prophets. What are they doing? فَيَنْفَوْنَ عَنْهُ تَحْرِيفِ الْغَالِينَ. And they negate from this religion the distortion of those extremists are doing to the religion. وانتحال المبطلين وتأويل الجاهلين. And the ignorant ones who are distorting the religion, those who are bringing falsehood into the religion, what are they doing? They are negating it from the religion. فيحق الله الحق ويبطل الباطل ولو كره المشركون. And Allah brings the truth to its place, and the falsehood becomes clear to the people, even if the pagans and the polytheists dislike it. فالكتب المنزلة. Ibn Taymiyyah says the books that have been sent down min as-sama'i from the sky. Wal atharatu min al-'ilmi, and knowledge. Al ma'thuratu, that has been transmitted. An khatam al-anbiya'i, from the messengers. Or the final messenger, Nabiullah Muhammad. Yamiz Allah biha al-haqqu min al-batili. The truth becomes clear from the falsehood. Wa yahkumu bayna an-nasi fi ma ikhtalafu fi. And it is through it Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala judges between the people in that which they dispute one another. So my brothers and sisters, this religion, there are always going to be a people who are trying to play around with the deen, distort it, corrupt it. There is always going to be people who do that. He also says, وَإِذَا كَانَ النُّصْحُ وَاجِبًا فِي الْمَصَالِحِ الدِّينِيَّةِ
الخاصة والعامة مثل نقلة الحديث الذين يغلطون أو يكذبون كما قال يحيى بن سعيد سألت مالكا والثورية والليث بن سعد أظنه والأوزاعي عن الرجل يتهم في الحديث أو لا يحفظ فقالوا بين أبره وقال بعضهم لأحمد بن حنبل إنه يثقل علي أن أقول فلان كذا وفلان كذا فقال إذا سكت أنت وسكت أنا فمتى يعرف الجاهل الصحيح من السقيم ومثل أئمة البدع من أهل البدع المقالات المخالفة للكتاب والسنة أو العبادات المخالفة للكتاب والسنة فإن بيان حالهم وتحذير الأمة منهم واجب باتفاق المسلمين حتى قيل لأحمد بن حنبل الرجل يصوم ويصلي ويعتكف أحب إليك أو يتكلم في أهل البدع فقال إذا قام فقال أحمد إذا قام وصلى واعتكف فإنما هو لنفسه وإذا تكلم في أهل البدع فإنما هو للمسلمين هذا أفضل فبين أن نفع هذا عام للمسلمين في دينهم من جنس الجهاد في سبيل الله إذ تطهير سبيل الله ودينه ومنهاجه وشرعته ودفع بغي هؤلاء وعدوانهم على ذلك واجب على الكفاية باتفاق المسلمين ولولا من يقيمه الله لدفع ضرر هؤلاء لفسد الدين وكان فساده أعظم من فساد استيلاء العدو من أهل الحرب فإن هؤلاء إذا استولوا لم يفسدوا القلوب وما فيها من الدين إلا تبعا وأما أولئك فهم يفسدون القلوب ابتداء. ابن تيمية said a كلام يستحق أن يكتب بماء الذهب. Ibn Taymiyyah, he said, if sincere advice is obligatory في المصالح الدينية in beneficial issues of the deen, whether it be خاصة أو والعامة, matters which are general or specific issues, sincere advice is obligatory, such as مثل نقلة الحديث, those who are transmitting a hadith to us, الذين يغلطون أو يكذبون, they lie or they might even do mistakes unintentionally. As Yahya ibn Sa'id in al-Ansari, he said, I asked Malik and Thawri, Sufyan al-Thawri, walayth ibn Sa'ad, wal-Awza'i, and also Awza'i, عن الرجل يتهم في الحديث, a man is suspecting, there's a suspicion regarding his narrations, أو لا يحفظ, or he doesn't memorize, he's not precise in his memorization. فقالوا, they said, all of them said to me, بَيِّنْ أَمَرَهُ, clarify his matters. This man narrates, but his memory is not good. He always forgets. Or he lies about the Prophet ﷺ. He's suspected of lying. What should we do? Malik ibn Anas, Sufyan al-Thawri, Layth ibn Sa'ad. Malik is Imam Ahl al-Sham. So Sufyan al-Thawri, Sufyan ibn Masruq al-Thawri, rahimahullah. Layth ibn Sa'ad, Imam Ahl al-Misra. Al-Awza'i is the Imam of the people of Sham. All of those great Imams of Islam. All of them, they said, "Bayin amrah," clarify this issue. And today we have people saying, "Akhi, don't." Ani, akhi, let's agree to disagree. Let's just let them be. What does this person know that these great imams don't know? وَقَالَ بَعْضُهُمْ لِأَحْمَدَ بْنَ حَنْبَلٍ. Some people, they came to Ahmad ibn Hanbal and they said to him, "Inno yathqulu alayya," it's hard on me. And أَقُولَ فُلَانٌ كَذَا وَفُلَانٌ كَذَا. I can't do it. I can't say so-and-so is this and so-and-so is that. I can't do that. It's too heavy on me. Some people, they said that to Ahmad ibn Hanbal. We can't speak about people. We can't say so-and-so is this and so-and-so is that. It's too hard on us. So Imam Ahmad said to them, إِذَا سَكَتْتَ أَنْتَ, if you are silent, وَسَكَتْتُ أَنَا, and I'm also silent, فَمَتَى يَعْرِفُ الْجَاهِلُ الصَّحِيحَ مِنَ السَّقِيمِ, when is the person who's ignorant going to know what is right from what is wrong? What is authentic and what is weak? When is he going to know? Then Ibn Taymiyyah said, وَمِثْلُ أَئِمَّةِ الْبِدَعِ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْمَقَالَاتِ الْمُخَالِفَةِ لِلْكِتَابِ وَالسُّنَّةِ أَوِ الْعِبَادَاتِ الْمُخَالِفَةِ لِلْكِتَابِ وَالسُّنَّةِ. Ibn Taymiyyah, he said, the innovators whose statements are in opposition to the Kitab and the Sunnah, or their acts of worship is in opposition to the Kitab and the Sunnah, فَإِنَّ بَيَانَ حَالِمْ, to clarify these people's situation, these innovators whose statements are in opposition to the Qur'an and the Sunnah, or those people whose act of worship is in opposition to the Qur'an and the Sunnah, clarifying their situation and warning the ummah, وَتَحْذِيرَ الْأُمَّةِ مِنْهُمْ, and warning the ummah from them,
is wajibun bittifaqil muslimina. It's an obligation by unanimous agreement of the Muslims. Underline that point. It is wajibun bittifaqil muslimina. It's unanimously agreed upon by the Muslims. Hatta qila li Ahmad ibn Hanbali. To the extent that it was said to Ahmad ibn Hanbal, ar-rajulu yasumu, a man fasts, wa yusalli, and he prays, wa ya'takif, and he does it i'tikaf, wa ya'takifu. Ahabbu ilayka, is that person more beloved to you? The one who prays, he fasts, he's doing i'tikaf, and he's busy with himself. Do you love that person more? Aw yatakallamu fi ahli al-bid'ah, or a person who is speaking about the people of innovation. Which one do you love more? Ask the people today this question. Ask the same question to so many people today. Say to them, Akhi, which one do you love? A person who's exposing the people of innovation, or the person who prays and he fasts and he does good acts of worship and he's busy with himself? Which one do you love? All of the people, a majority of the people say to you, Illa man rahima rabbi. The majority of the people say to you, the one who busies himself with himself, who fasts, who prays, who does good and gives sadaqah, is more beloved to us. Ah. That person is more beloved to us. Take out the sadaqah out of there. Sadaqah is a fi'il muta'addi. Lakin, the one who prays and who fasts, the one who prays, he fasts and he does it i'tikaf. Do you guys love that person? How's that person? Wallahi Allahumma bari. He's good. He's busy with himself. He doesn't busy himself with other people. He's more concerned about his own affairs. That's what we're going to say. That's what we'll say. And the one who speaks about the innovators, we'll be like, hey, all day he's just speaking about people's honor. That's what we say. And we prefer the person who fasts, and we see him fasting a lot. Mondays and Thursdays he's fasting, every other day he's fasting. Or he's praying a lot, and he's doing i'tikaf a lot. We love that person more than the one who exposes the innovators. What did Ahmed say, lakin? Imam Ahlu Sunnah. He said, إِذَا قَامَ وَصَلَّى. If the person prays, وَاَعْتَكَفَ, and he does i'tikaf, فَإِنَّمَا هُوَ لِنَفْسِهِ. He's doing this for himself. وَإِذَا تَكَلَّمَ فِي أَهْلِ الْبِدَعِ. But if he speaks about the innovators, فَإِنَّمَا هُوَ لِلْمُسْلِمِينَ. He's doing this for the Muslims. هَذَا أَفْضَلِ. This is better. Ahmed compared two things, which is what? He compared a fi'il. Actions are two types. There's an action which is fi'il, which is qasir, and there's a fi'il which is mutaaddi. Fi'il which is qasir is the action that's restricted to you. It's only restricted to you. And there is an action which is not restricted to you. It also involves other people. Ahmed gave precedence to the action that involves other people than the one that's restricted to you. Because if you pray, you're only doing it for yourself. If you're fasting, you're doing it for yourself. If you're going to do itikaf, you're doing that all for yourself. Lakin, exposing the people of innovation, فَإِنَّمَا هُوَ لِلْمُسْلِمِينَ. This is an act that it brings other people in. And when scholars, they talk about tafadul bayn al-ibadat, choosing between acts of worship, one of the ways that they choose between it is which action is restricted to you and which action involves others. The one that involves others is better than the one that's restricted to you. Are we all together, brothers? No. So this is Ahmed's statement. And then look what Ibn Taymiyyah said after that. He said, فَبَيَّنَا. He clarified to us, أَنَّ نَفْعَ هَذَا عَامٌ لِلْمُسْلِمِينَ فِي دِينِهِمْ مِنْ جِنْسِ الْجِهَادِ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. And it's a type of jihad. This is better because it's general. It benefits other people. When you say to the people, يَا أَخِي, this person is an innovator. ابْتَعِدْ عَنْهُ. This person is an innovator. He's calling to misguidance. You're benefiting everybody. You're even benefiting the person you're exposing, because you're stopping him from going to the hellfire. He might realize, oh, I didn't know that I was upon this misguidance. So he comes to his senses and he understands. You saved him. If he's a true seeker of khair and he wants Jannah, he'll be happy what you did. Okay? So, it's jihad fi sabilillah. إِذْ تَطْهِيرُ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَدِينِهِ وَمِنْهَاجِهِ وَشِرْعَتِهِ وَدَفْعِ بَغْيِ هَؤُلَاءِ وَعُدْوَانِهِمْ عَلَى ذَلِكَ وَاجِمٌ عَلَى الْكِفَايَةِ بِاتِفَاقِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. Purifying the religion and the methodology of the Prophet and the legislation from the transgression of these innovators and these wrongdoers and their exceeding of their limits. It's a wajib al-kifaya. It's a communal obligation. بِاتِفَاقِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. By unanimous agreement of the Muslims. By the way, this is not a differed on issue. Just recently we see people saying, Akhi, leave refutation. This matter of refuting is a unanimous agreed upon issue. Even those ones who are saying to you, don't refute, they themselves are refuting the ones who refute. When they say, Akhi, stop refuting, leave this refutation culture, by default what they're doing themselves is refuting as well, because they're saying that what those people are doing is wrong. It's a refutation. Okay, brothers? So don't say to yourself that no one is doing refutation. Every single person is doing refutation. Even the one who calls the people to good manners is refuting bad manners. It's telling the people to stay away from bad manners. Okay, brothers? And I've always said this point, and I want everybody to think about it. Some people, they will refute the Shia, but they won't refute, for example, the Sufiya. I now say to you, you have chosen to refute the Shia. And this person has chosen to refute the Shia and the Sufiya. On what grounds have you chosen who to refute and who not? Because both of them are going against the truth. Ponder here. It's very important you understand this. The one who refutes those who apostated from Islam now, he's refuting falsehood. Why are you not refuting the ones who are innovating in the religion? They're also upon falsehood. Yeah, you're right. The falsehood is not the same level. There are different levels of falsehood. That's correct. But again, it's still falsehood. So if you say to the ones who are refuting the Sufi and the Sha'ira, the Diobandiya, wahakada, then, and you say, Akhi, stop this. We want another person can come to you and say to you, Akhi, stop refuting the Shia. Leave them alone. Why are you refuting them for? Ya Akhi, let's unite, which we already have people saying that. And another person might say to you, Akhi, leave these Murtadeen who apostated from Islam. Leave them alone. Why are you always going after them for? If they've chosen to leave Islam, it's their choice. Leave them alone. Another person can come. And then another one can come and say, Akhi, why are you refuting the Christians for? Akhi, look, humanity. We're all humans. وَهَلُمَّ جَرَّهَا. Okay? So, it's, as I say, it's الْكَيْلُ بِمِكْيَالَيْنِ وَالْوَزْمُ بِمِزَانَيْنِ. It's أَحَلَالٌ عَلَى بَلَابِلِهِ دَوْحُ حَلَالٌ لِلطَّيْرِ مِنْ كُلِّ جِنْسِ. You're saying it's allowed for me to refute the Murtadeen. It is allowed for me to refute the Shia. It's allowed for me to refute all the other groups. But then don't refute this particular group. And the only reason why you would say don't refute this particular group is not because you're against refutation per se, because you're doing it to the Shia, is because you agree with this particular group. You're a sympathizer most likely with the Sufiya or the Diobandiya or with the Brelwiya and whatever. Anyone who does falsehood, كائنا من كان, whoever that person is, it should be clarified. حتى ولو من أهل السنة, even if it's from أهل السنة, we will point out the mistake and we'll bring it to the people's attention. And inshallah ta'ala, a person of the sunnah, inshallah ta'ala, won't get angry. Because what he wants is the truth to be cleared. That's what his whole mission and his whole da'wah is about. That the truth is clarified. Now when we say that the mistake of the person, we don't mean his personal mistakes. Or little mistakes he's fallen into his personal life. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about issues of the religion. Ibn Taymiyyah here is talking about and Ahmad ibn Hanbal and Ishaq ibn Rahuya and Sufyan al-Thawri and Layth ibn Sa'd and Imam al-Awza'i and يعني, Malik ibn Anas. They're talking about issues of the religion. Okay? Issues of the religion. Amma, people's personal life, من نفس عن مؤمن كربة من كرب الدنيا نفس الله عنه كربة من كرب اليوم ومن ستر مسلما ستره الله في الدنيا والآخرة. If you conceal the mistake and the fault of a Muslim brother, what they've done privately, and it's, you get rewarded for يوم القيامة. You don't expose them publicly, you don't speak about it publicly. But talking about this honorable religion, and that's what Ibn Taymiyyah means here, رحمه الله رحمة واسعة, when he says ودفع بغي هؤلاء وعدوانهم على ذلك واجب على الكفاية باتفاق المسلمين ولولا من يقيمه الله لدفع ضرر هؤلاء. And if Ibn Taymiyyah goes on to say, if there was not a people to stand up to deflect and block the harm that these people are putting to the religion, وكان فساده أعظم من فساد استيلاء العدو من أهل الحرب. Ibn Taymiyyah said that these people, pay attention here, their harm is worse than the harm of the non-Muslims who are fighting with us. The innovators are more harmful for the Muslims than the disbeliever. Now, brothers, pay attention here. Ibn Taymiyyah is not saying that the Mubtadi' is in a worse place, Yawm al-Qiyamah, in the hellfire than the disbelievers. He doesn't mean that. When he says that their harm is more for the religion, yani they harm the religion more than the disbeliever. Why? Because the disbeliever fights from outside And the mubtadi' is fighting from within. And the one who's fighting from within causes more harm than the one that's fighting from outside. I'll give you a practical example. You have a house, you're inside a house, and an enemy is trying to attack you from outside. You lock your doors, you might survive for maybe a long time, or even fully survive from the enemy that's attacking you from outside. But what about if someone is attacking you from within the house? How do you defend yourself? And inshallah ta'ala, later I'm going to give you a kalam sarih, clear in that issue. That Ibn Aqil, rahimahullah ta'ala, Abu Lufa Ibn Aqil, rahimahullah, said, the great Hanbali scholar, that Ibn al-Jawzi mentions in his kitab al-Mawdu'at, I'm going to mention it inshallah ta'ala. The enemies of Islam who are coming from outside, they generally, a lot of them don't know about Islam a lot. Who are the ones who give to the people the faults of Islam? Who are the ones who tell them? The mubtadi'a do. They say this is the fault, this is a weak point of the Muslims, attack them from here, they do this to the Muslims, this is where they're weak from. And that's where the enemies of Islam get things from, ammunition from. A lot of them don't know about Islam and anything. You hear today the Orientalists saying that the Qur'an is distorted and the Qur'an is not protected and it wasn't preserved. وهكذا. Who originally gave them this ammunition? The Rafida did. Or early, as Ibn Hazm, rahimahullah, mentioned in the Kitab al-Fisal, fil milal wal-ahwa'i wal-nihal. That the Rafida were the first people to say that the Qur'an was changed and distorted. And one of them even wrote a book on it, saying that the Qur'an is muharraf and it's distorted and the Qur'an is not preserved, as Allah said, إِلَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا ذِكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. So these people give ammunition, and then the non-Muslims take it from there. They take that whole entire argument from the mubtadi'ah. So they are more harmful for the Muslims than the disbelievers. Are we all together, brothers? Ha. So now inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to read the statement of Ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah ta'ala, something very powerful he said. He said, قَالَ أَبُو الْوَفَاءِ عَلِيِّ بْنَ عَقِيلٍ الْفَقِيهِ. Abu al-Wafa, Ali ibn Aqil al-Faqih, is a Hanbali jurist. He said, قَالَ شَيْخُنَا أَبُو الْفَضْلِ الْهَمَذَانِي. Ibn Aqil is quoting his teacher, Abu al-Fadl al-Hamadhani, said, مُبْتَدِعَةُ الْإِسْلَامِ وَالْوَاضِعُونَ لِلْحَدِيثِ أَشَدُّ مِنَ الْمُلْحِدِينَ. That the innovators who innovate in the religion and those who fabricate narrations in the hadiths are أَشَدُّ مِنَ الْمُلْحِدِينَ, they are worse than the mulhideen, the disbelievers. They're worse than them. Why? لِأَنَّ الْمُلْحِدِينَ قَصَدُوا إِفْسَادَ الدِّينِ بِلَى الْخَارِجِ. This is explaining what I said before about when I was explaining the kalam of Imam Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, which is these people, he said, the mulhideen, they قَصَدُوا إِفْسَادَ الدِّينِ مِنَ الْخَارِجِ. They intended to harm the religion from outside. وَهَؤُلَاءِ قَصَدُوا إِفْسَادَهُ مِنَ الدَّاخِلِ. Like in the innovators, they chose to harm the religion from within. And then he gives you an example to relate to. He says, فَهُمْ كَأَهْلِ بَلَدٍ سَعُوا فِي فَسَادِ أَحْوَالِهِ. They're like a people of a land who chose to destroy and corrupt their own land. That's what innovators are like. وَالْمُلْحِدُونَ كَالْمُحَاصِرِينَ مِنَ الْخَارِجِ. And the disbelievers are like a people who are doing a siege on that people of that land. فَالدُّخَلَاءِ يَفْتَحُونَ الْحِصْنَ. Who are the ones who are going to open the fortress first? They're the ones inside first. فَهُمْ شَرٌ عَلَى الْإِسْلَامِ مِنْ غَيْرِ الْمُلَابِسِينَ لَهُ. These people who are within Islam, who claim to be a Muslim, are more harmful to the Islam and the religion than those who are not claiming to be from the Muslims. Ibn al-Jawzi mentions that in his kitab, Al-Mawdu'at, the first volume, page 51. Hafiz Abdul Ghani, Abdul Wahid Al-Maqdisi, the author of the kitab, Umdatul Ahkam, the kitab that we study, Umdatul Ahkam, he says something very powerful, rahimahullah rahmatan wasa'. He says, وَعْلَمْ نَوْ رَحِمَكَ اللَّهِ, may Allah have mercy upon you, أَنَّ الْإِسْلَامَ وَأَهْلَهُ, Islam and its people, أُوتُوا مِنْ طَوَائِفَ ثَلَاثَ, the harm came to them from three groups. طَائِفَةٌ رَدَّتْ أَحَادِيثَ الصِّفَاتِ. The harm has come to the Muslims from three groups. The first group is طَائِفَةٌ رَدَّتْ أَحَادِيثَ الصِّفَاتِ, a group of people who rejected the أَحَادِيثُ الصِّفَاتِ. Now, pause here and stop and think. Abdul Ghani Abdul Wahid Al-Maqdisi, the great Imam, the cousin of Muwaffaquddin ibn Qudam Al-Maqdisi, rahimahullah, may Allah have mercy upon both of them. Abdul Ghani went towards the hadith side, and Muwaffaquddin ibn Qudama went towards the fiqh side. Both of them, that's how they took part. They studied together, by the way, both of them. Sought knowledge together. One went towards the hadith side, and one went towards the fiqh side. That doesn't mean the other one doesn't know what hadith or fiqh, or the other one doesn't know fiqh or hadith. It means they specialized in this. And Abdul Ghani ibn Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi authored the Kitab al-Kamal. The Kitab al-Kamal fi Ma'rifat al-Rijal, which then Abu al-Hajjaj al-Mizzi came after, and he summarized it and he abridged it, and he called it Tahdib al-Kamal. And then Ibn Hajar came, Mughalatai and Dahabi and all of them came and they summarized it, till Ibn Hajar came and he summarized it to the Kitab al-Taqrib. And then he even made Tahdib of that one, and wahakada. The point is, brothers, Abdul Ghani Abdul Wahid al-Maqdis is a great imam. He's saying, Rahimahullah, he's saying to me and you, he's talking to all of us. He's saying to us, I'lam, no, Muslims, may Allah have mercy upon you. أَنَّ الْإِسْلَامَ وَأَهْلَهُ أُوتُوا مِنْ طَوَائِفَ ثَلَاثَةً. The harm has come to the Muslims from three groups. The first group is فَطَائِفَةُ رَدَّتْ أَحَادِيثَ الصِّفَاتِ. A group of people who rejected hadith al-sifat, the hadith that speak about Allah's names and attributes. Today we have people who say that Allah's names and attributes, it's a dispute that was then, it's gone, it's no longer a problem. And it's dead and over, like khalas. Let's not make an issue out of it. Let's leave it. Do we trust these people and we believe what they say, or do we trust this great imam? I want you to all think over and ponder over that point. He's saying that these people who rejected hadith al-sifat are the harm that has come to the Muslims and the religion of Islam. وَكَذَبُوا رُوَاتَهَا. What they did is they classified the narrators as liars. فَهَاُولَاءِ Ibn عبد الغني عبد الواحد المقدسي said, فَهَاُولَاءِ أَشَدُّ ضَرَرًا عَلَى الْإِسْلَامِ وَأَهْلِهِ مِنَ الْكُفَّارِ. These people are more harmful for the religion of Islam than the disbelievers are. I never said that. I'm just a transmitter. Listen to this now. وَطَائِفَةٌ, the second group. Remember, he said three groups have harmed this religion. The first one we already mentioned. The second group are who? قَالُوا بِصِحَّتِهَا. They said that these ahadiths are sahih. They're not like the first ones. The first one rejected those ahadiths, like the Mu'tazila. The second group, he said, no. وَقَالُوا بِصِحَّتِهَا. They accepted those ahadiths. وَقَبِلُوهَا, and they accepted it. ثُمَّ تَأَوَّلُوهَا, and then they distorted its meaning. فَهَؤُلَاءِ أَعْظَمُ ضَرَرًا مِنَ الطَّائِفَةِ الْأُولَى. These ones are more harmful than the first group. And the first group were what? The first group were more harmful than the disbelievers. So they are worse than the group who's worse than the disbelievers. وَالثَّالِثَةِ, he said the third group are who? جَانَبُ الْقَوْلَيْنِ. They went against both those groups and they made an even worse claim. And then he said, وَكَانُوا أَعْظَمُ ضَرَرًا مِنَ الطَّائِفَةِ الْأُولَيَيْنِ. These, the third group, is worse than the two previous ones. So we have Ibn Taymiyyah. We have Abu al-Fadl al-Hamadani, who Ibn al-Jawzi transmitted that Abu al-Wafa ibn Aqil said. So Ibn al-Jawzi is affirming this statement as well. Also, so is Abu al-Wafa ibn Aqil and his teacher Abu al-Fadl al-Hamadani. And we also have Ibn Taymiyyah. All four of them are saying that the innovators are more harmful to Islam and the Muslims than the disbelievers are. Okay, that's why it's important to expose them. They're not the only people. Even Shatibi said the same thing. Abu Ishaq al-Shatibi said the same thing. Abu Ishaq al-Shatibi mentions a kalam. I'm going to read it on you, brothers and sisters. I want to all listen to it and ponder and contemplate with me here. He says, حَيْثُ تَكُونُ الْفِرْقَةُ تَدْعُو إِلَى ضَلَالَتِهَا وَتَزِيِّنِهَا فِي قُلُوبِ الْعَوَامِ وَمَنْ لَا عِلْمَ عِنْدَهُ فَإِنَّ ضَرَرَ هَؤُلَاءِ عَلَى الْمُسْلِمِينَ كَضَرَرِ إِبْلِيسَ وَهُمْ مِنَ شَيَاطِينِ الْإِنْسِ فَلَا بُدَّ مِنَ التَّصْرِيحِ بِأَنَّهُمْ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْبِدْعَةِ وَالضَّلَالَةِ وَنِسْبَتُهُمْ إِلَى الْفِرْقَةِ إِذَا قَامَتْ لَهُ شُهُودٌ عَلَى أَنَّهُمْ مِنْهُمْ كَمَا اشْتَهَرَ عَنْ عَمْرُو بْنِ عُبَيْدٍ وَغَيْرِهِ until he went on to say, فَمِثْلُ هَؤُلَاءِ لَا بُدَّ مِنْ ذِكْرِهِمْ وَالتَّشْرِيدِ بِهِمْ لِأَنَّ مَا يَعُودُ عَلَى الْمُسْلِمِينَ مِنْ ضَرَرِهِمْ إِذَا تُرِكُوا أَعْظَمُ مِنَ الضَّرَرِ الْحَاصِلِ بِذِكْرِهِمْ وَالتَّنْفِيرِ عَنْهُمْ. Al-Imam Abu Ishaq al-Shatibi in his Kitab al-I'tisam, he talks about something very important, which is sometimes people don't like naming people. I don't like naming people. Unrestrictedly. Shatibi says something very powerful. He said, حَيْثُ تَكُونُ الْفِرْقَةُ تَدْعُ إِلَى ضَلَالَةِ. If a group of people are calling to misguidance, وَتَزْيِينِهَا, and they beautify it, فِي قُلُوبِ الْعَوَامِ, in the hearts of the general mass, وَمَنْ لَا عِلْمَ عِنْدَهُ, and they beautify this falsehood to a people who have no knowledge, فَإِنَّ ضَرَرَ هَؤُلَاءِ, the harm that these people will have upon, عَلَى الْمُسْلِمِينَ, on the Muslims, كَضَرَرِ إِبْلِيسَ, is like the harm that Iblis would have on the people. Do you know anyone worse than Iblis, brothers and sisters? Do you know anyone worse than Iblis? Iblis is worse than the kuffar. He's the worst of the worst. Okay? The harm that these people will have on the Muslims is worse than that which any other people can have on us, brothers and sisters. You have to understand that. He says, kabarari Iblis. Their harm is like Iblis, he's saying. Wahum min shayateen al-ins. They are shaytan of this world. They are shayateen al-ins. That's what they are. Fala budda. It is necessary. من التصريح, to point them out, بأنهم من أهل البدعة والضلالة. We point them out. We say, you're innovator. You're a people of misguidance. ونسبتهم إلى الفرق. And we have to attribute them to the deviated group. إذا قامت له شهود على أنهم منهم. As if there is witnesses, proofs that they are from them. You can't just claim every somebody that you're a مبتدع. You're a مبتدع. He's saying to you, الإمام الشاطبي, ونسبتهم إلى الفرق إذا إلى الفرق. إِذَا قَامَتْ لَهُ الشُّهُودُ عَلَى أَنَّهُ مِنْهُمْ. There has to be witnesses testifying that this person is from that deviated ideology and group. Well, everyone would have just claimed. كَمَا اشْتُهِرَ عَنْ عَمْرُ بْنُ عُبَيْدٍ وَغَيْرِ. As it's clearly been transmitted regarding Amr ibn Ubayd, who is a Mu'tazili. Then Shatibi went on to say it after a bit. He says, فَمِثْلُ هَؤُلَاءِ. These types of people. لَا بُدَّ مِنْ ذِكْرِهِمْ. You have to mention them. Sometimes, لا, فَمَا بَالُ أَقْوَامٍ might not work. You have to name them, fulan and fulan and fulan. فَمِثْلُ هَؤُلَاءِ لَا بُدَّ مِنْ ذِكْرِهِمْ. Sometimes you need to name them. وَالتَّشْرِيدِ بِهِمْ. And you have to disperse the people from them. لِأَنَّ مَا يَعُودُ عَلَى الْمُسْلِمِينَ مِنْ ضَرَرِهِمْ. Because the harm that will come to the Muslims from these people, إِذَا تُرِكُوا, if they left, أَعْظَمُ مِنَ الضَّرَرِ الْحَاسِلِ بِذِكْرِهِمْ وَتَنْفِيرِ عَنُهُمْ, is a greater harm than naming them and dispersing the people from them. يعني what he's saying here is, Imam al-Shatibi, causing disunity, causing disperse. And he, of course, when you expose him, he's going to cut off with a group of people. And the other people, you're going to tell them, don't listen to him. And sometimes a whole issue happens. Shatibi saying that is better than leaving him to be. Sometimes to point him out and name him and expose him is a greater harm by being silent about him and letting him do his falsehood is a greater silence than the harm that might come if you expose him, you name him, you disperse the people from him. Of course, he's not going to love you if you expose him. He's going to try to fight back. He's going to try to defend his position and his self. He's going to try to do all of that. Like, we're going to take the lesser of the two harms. Sahib al-Maraqi said, وَارْتَكِي بِالْأَخَفَّ مِنْ ضُرَّيْنِ وَخَيِّرًا لَدَسْتَوَى هَذَيْنِ. He says, if there's two harms, what do? We take the lesser of two harms. ولذلك, even Sa'di rahimahullah, he said, الدِّينُ مَبْنِيُّ عَلَى الْمَصَالِحِ فِي جَلْبِهَا وَدَرْءِ لِلْقَبَائِحِ فَإِنْ تَزَاحَمْ عَدَدُ الْمَصَالِحِ يُقَدَّمُ الْأَعْلَى مِنَ الْمَصَالِحِ وَضِدُّ تَزَاحُمُ الْمَفَاسِدِ يُرْتَكَبُ الْأَدْنَى مِنَ الْمَفَاسِدِ. If there's two harms running besides one another, what do? We take the lesser of the two harms. We're going to take the lesser of the two harms here. Because there is a harm in causing disunity and causing problems amongst the community and discord, and it's a harm, no doubt. But it's a greater harm to be silent about this type of person. Shatibi is saying this. So those who claim all the time, masalih al-mafasid, mura'at al-masalih al-mafasid, this is a maslaha that you need to look at, which is tathiru shari'ati Allah azza wa jalla, purifying the path of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, and not letting the people of misguidance just do what they want. I'm going to stop there, inshallah wa ta'ala. I have, alhamdulillah, from the Qur'an and the Sunnah and from the statements of the great Imams of Al-Islam, I have proven the importance of refuting and how it is a matter that is not disputed about. There's no khilaf in that matter. I hope I've done that in this episode, inshallah wa ta'ala. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect, it's from me and shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are both free from it. سبحانك اللهم بحمد أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله استغفرك وأتوب إليه.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. How can you do a 2-second action right now that will give you a share of the reward of everything we're doing on this YouTube channel? Simple. Like this video and click subscribe. Why? It will allow YouTube to recommend our videos to other users. And imagine the huge amount of reward that could be waiting for you on the Day of Judgment if you did that with a sincere intention of spreading the Deen of Allah. You'll be rewarded for every single person who benefits from one of our videos as a result of your like or subscribe. That's an easy 2-second action that you definitely don't want to miss out on. Do it now, click like and subscribe, and don't forget to make that intention.